Good afternoon, everyone. While we are currently all in different locations, I would like to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners of the lands on which we each live and work. I'm speaking to you from the lands of the Wurundjeri Nation. I pay my respects to their elders past, present, and emerging, and to any First Nations people who may be joining us today. Sovereignty has never been ceded. I am Ruth Gormley. I lead the strategic marketing team at Creative Victoria and look after the CV side of the Creative Exchange Arts Hub partnership behind these Recovery Roadmap webinars. My preferred pronouns are she and her. And at this point, I have to admit that my computer has done something very strange and I have lost my script. So I am not going to remember all of the things I need to tell you about. I can tell you that we today are speaking with Kate Cuthbert from Writers Victoria and Jeremy from MTC about monetising digital events. We are recording this, so anything you ask will be on record. And we are captioning this. Richard will probably be able to tell you how to access those captions. I can't do it with what I have without what I had written down. I just want to acknowledge that we're all reeling a bit at the moment, with lockdowns and uncertainty across the country impacting everyone's life, work, and practice, and that we hope that some of the ideas that Kate and Jeremy are sharing in this event will help you think your way through it. I am going to pass over to Richard Watts from Arts Hub, who is managing this conversation today. I hope you all enjoy the session. Thanks.
Thank you, Ruth. Womanjika, welcome. I'm Richard Watts. I'm the Performing Arts Editor of Arts Hub, and I'm speaking to you today from the lands of the Kulin Nation, and I too would like to pay my respects to elders past, present, and emerging, and to acknowledge that sovereignty has never been ceded. This always was and will be Aboriginal land. For today's session, exploring monetising digital events, as Ruth mentioned, if you haven't yet accessed the closed captions, please click on the live transcript button with the letters CC at the bottom of your screen. If you're going to tweet or comment about today on social media, please use the hashtags Recovery Roadmap Webinar. That's all one word. This session will explore the challenges of staging online events. Last year, so many organisations, as we know, pivoted to presenting work online. Now, a lot of that work was initially free. One of the challenges for organisations in the arts is to work out how to monetise those streaming events, those archived videos and so forth. How do you persuade an audience to go from accessing something for free at the height of the pandemic last year to paying for events now in lockdown six here in Melbourne, and my commiserations to our colleagues around the country, Darwin, Canberra, Sydney, and other areas, all of New South Wales, in fact, in lockdown as well. So we're going to explore some of those themes today around monetizing digital events. If you have any questions for our speakers as the event unfolds, you'll be able to ask them using the Q&A function, again, at the bottom of your screen. We may not get time for every question, but we'll certainly do our best to ask as many of them as we can. Now, our guests for this webinar are Kate Cuthbert, who's the Program and Partnerships Manager at Writers Victoria. She previously worked in trade publishing, notably initiating the Escape Publishing imprint of Harlequin, Australia. She is an advocate of genre fiction and also an enthusiast of genre fiction as well, and is currently pursuing a PhD examining rural settings in Australian popular fiction. She's also the co-host of the podcast, What Would Danbury Do? I'll introduce our second speaker, Jeremy Rice from the Melbourne Theatre Company's MTC Digital Theatre Project in more detail in a moment. But right now, Kate, over to you to present some initial remarks about how you and the team at Writers Victoria transition from real world events into the digital sphere.
Thanks so much, Richard, and thank you everyone who's joining us today. Just as a really, really quick introduction, so Writers Victoria is the state's peak body to support writers. We have about 2,500 members and a small staff. Generally speaking, we provide a few different avenues for support for writers, many of which were unaffected by the stay-at-home orders last year and currently, including services like our manuscript assessments and our feedback clinics. However, there were a few large areas of service and income that were affected. So our professional and creative development program, which is mainly through our workshop program, is one of our main income streams, but it's also an important way that we support writers as well. Writers Victoria is the biggest employer of writers in Australia. We regularly employ over 100 writers a year through our workshop program alone. We also were struggling with creating social and networking opportunities and more ad hoc support opportunities, providing space for writers to write and to speak to or learn from other writers. So this includes the spontaneous networking or support that was available via the use of our library space, for example, or in the several breakout spaces that we have access to at the Wheeler Center. It also included groups like our First Friday Write Club and support for our writers groups, again, through those spaces. And finally, Writers Victoria is a not-for-profit organization. We do receive partial funding from Creative Victoria, but we run on a cost recovery model for the sustainability of our programs and services, which meant that we were not in a position to deliver any aspect of our current paid program for free. So when we started, when we were put into stay-at-home orders, we had to figure out how to pivot, to use that word, to an online model without taking away any of the financial sustainability that that program provided for us. So if we look at our workshop program, which is our biggest program in terms of our professional and creative development, these workshops were already being run at a really competitive price, and they were run at a price in line with our desire to pay the tutors a reasonable rate for the work that they do. With many of the artists and writers already facing extreme financial precarity, it was not a solution for us to cut the fees for the amount, for the same amount of work. So we had to make our online program as valuable as our in-person program, and importantly, communicate that value to our members and to other writers who may access it. And further, we had to upskill. We had not done nearly enough to learn how to effectively deliver an online program. And importantly, we hadn't taught our community well enough how to engage online either. So we had to upskill ourselves in delivering quality online content and teach our writers how to engage and learn in an online model as well. So the way that we did this was we looked at our program and we identified four key areas of engagement or needs that were being met by our in-person program. And these key areas are education and information, access to tutors, access to community, and feedback on work. And we had to look at how we could meet each of those needs online. Because our creative or professional development program covers a number of different areas of writing and publishing, there wasn't really one model that fit everything. So we came up with two separate styles. For both, at the beginning of the sessions, we strongly encouraged introductions with everyone, including names, where they were zooming in from, and what they were working on. We also strongly encouraged gallery view throughout and leaving cameras on as much as possible. We provided what was probably over-detailed information on how to use the chat function, and really encouraged people to drop their thoughts through the chat function as the day progressed to encourage interaction and discussion. It also had the benefit of not interrupting the tutor, which is one of the downsides of teaching via Zoom. So the first style of workshop mimicked an in-person workshop as closely as possible in terms of structure, but we built in the necessary OH&S elements for safety and comfort, including very frequent, very regular breaks to step away from screens and to help combat screen fatigue. But the second style of workshop was created specifically to meet those four key areas that I mentioned earlier. In this case, we ran the workshops quite differently. So for the first 3 hours, the workshop tutor would essentially lecture on a topic, providing most of the information that they were sharing about that topic at the beginning of the day. These ran for mostly an hour at a time with a 5-minute break here and there. And we're very much about a tutor sharing their knowledge. Then the sessions had an extended break of 2 hours where the writers were provided with deeper, more involved writing exercises and encouraged to take a long screen break, take a walk, eat some lunch, get some water, but also really engage with their writing, which meant that at the end of the day, when the group reconvened for Q&A sessions, the questions were quite targeted and focused and very useful from a pedagogical point of view because they were quite practice-led at that point in time. Finally, after the workshop, the participants were invited to submit a sample of their work for high-level feedback from the tutors afterwards, which provided that direct and personalized response about their writing and access to the tutor that they were looking for. So by running our sessions in this way and identifying what it was that our audience was getting out of our in-person workshop, we were able to provide the same level of quality online and also communicate how that value translated from an in-person workshop to an online workshop.
Hey, you done there?
Yes, I can be.
Cool. Let's continue the conversation in a moment in that case. I noticed that a couple of extra people have joined us. So if you've just joined, you're watching Monetising Digital Events, the latest recovery roadmap webinar co-presented by Arts Hub and Creative Victoria. And if you need to access the live transcript, please click on the CC button at the bottom of your screen. And if you want to ask questions, you can ask them via the Q&A function. Now, our next speaker is Jeremy Rice, the head of education at Melbourne Theatre Company and a member of the MTC Digital Theatre Project team. Jeremy's been involved in the planning and delivery of MTC Digital Theatre since its inception, in addition to producing online events and programs for MTC Education for several years before COVID. Jeremy draws on his experience as a director and post-production supervisor in TV, drama and documentary, and as the executive officer of youth arts companies in Darwin, Perth and Sydney. So, Jeremy, thank you for joining us and over to you.
Thanks, Richard. I am currently on Wurundjeri Woiwurrung land. Melbourne Theatre Company launches the Yalakut Willem peoples of the Boonwurrung, the first peoples of country on which Southbank Theatre and MTC HQ stand. And I pay my respects to all of Melbourne's first peoples, to their ancestors and elders, and to our shared future. I'm going to tell you briefly about MTC Digital Theatre, which is the project of producing, streaming, and monetising video recordings of MTC theatre productions. And this will include explaining very briefly just how MTC initiated this, our digital theatre project back in 2018, long before COVID was a thing. How we used our existing ticketing system and website to deliver MTC Digital Theatre. The importance of rigorous interrogation of the artistic values and practices behind digital theatre. And opportunities to monetize other events beyond main stage performances. So I can't see you, but I believe you can see me. Have you heard of MTC Digital Theatre? Bit of a rhetorical question. This morning I Googled that phrase without quotation marks, and the top result was indeed the digital event page on Melbourne Theatre Company website. Of course, I think Google already knows what website I visit most often. The second result was a short feature article titled From Our Stage to Your Screen, which gives a neat summary of our collaboration with Arts Centre Melbourne to produce MTC's first monetised digital event, Sexual Misconduct of the Middle Classes by Hannah Moscovich. And I think you can Google it, or I think the link will appear in the chat. We've since added an MTC digital theatre production of Berlin by John O'Mara Smith, and we intend to produce a third production this year. That is assuming we can actually produce the work on stage. So how did we start? Well, a key external impetus back in 2018 was to emulate the quality and success of National Theatre Live. A key internal impetus was to make MTC accessible to more audiences, especially those isolated by distance, disability, social, and other factors. And our initial focus was to produce monetized live online events for school audiences, and that was for these reasons. Conversations with rights holders were much easier when they were about a restricted education audience. Many Victorian secondary schools were already making use of MTC digital education resources. And the education sector sort of simplifies and facilitates targeting marginalised audiences. So when COVID hit, we were already in conversation with artists and agents about monetized digital events for education. We're really well positioned to expand those conversations to include general audiences. So how do we use our existing ticketing system and website? Well, like many large arts organisations, MTC uses Tessitura CRM. And from the start of the digital project, integrating the delivery platform with our ticketing was a deal breaker. We looked at lots of different platforms and the experience of other companies. We particularly looked at Melbourne International Film Festival. Ultimately, we found an online video player that we could integrate into our website, and we paid our web developers to ensure that Tessitura spoke to the video player through the website. So these are the advantages and economies of scale of a major arts organisation. We investigate a lot of other platforms, including sort of the more accessible ones in terms of finance, such as Vimeo OTT. No doubt other people will share knowledge in the conversation. So what do I mean by interrogating artistic values and practices when monetising digital events? Well, our initial focus on education provided two really useful provocations. One was that we are trying to emulate the perspective of an audience member in the theatre. The cameras only see what an audience member would see. And this continues to be one of the most reassuring statements that we can make to our artists when persuading them that this is a really, you know, valid enterprise. The second provocation is that students want to understand how theatre is made. So exposing or revealing our creative practices through a digital recording or live streaming is actually an asset and something that enhances the audience experience. And this has really helped us frame the conversation with our production partners on the relationship between the live performance and the digital event. So just on that last point, opportunities to monetize other events beyond main stage performances. So the paradigm for MTC Digital Theatre has been produce a live performance, and then during its season, either live stream or record the performance for online audiences. The current lockdown has really frustrated that paradigm because we can't get into our theatres, we can't get onto stage to perform. So, but long before this current situation, we had already been talking about, well, what about producing digital only events? Last year, we trialled and released free for audiences some audio dramas with varying levels of success and response. But we recognise that our community of artists around Melbourne Theatre Company have the capacity to create and deliver exciting hybrid works that remain essentially live storytelling but are experienced online. So that digital theatre page that I, it's titled From Our Stage to Your Screen, yeah, that's right, that I mentioned at the beginning, that will come up number one in your Google search, that will continue to be a gateway to, we hope, an ever-expanding suite of monetized digital events. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Jeremy. Look, Kate, I'll get you to turn your camera and microphone back on as well, please. And Jeremy, I'll get you to keep your camera and microphone on now so that we can have a conversation between the three of us. I guess to pick up something that is kind of key to what you're both doing, talk to us about kind of determining price points, what would work for both organisations in terms of Writers Victoria and Melbourne Theatre Company around what to charge your audiences for these events. And perhaps Kate, we'll start with you in that regard, and then Jeremy, bring you into the conversation as well. Because I'm keen to know, and I'm sure many of our viewers will be keen to know, how those conversations transpired internally and how you determine what was an attractive rather than off-putting price point for these kind of digital events.
Yeah, absolutely. So when we were having the conversations, when it became very clear that we were going to have to consider online delivery of our program, we didn't have a discussion about the price point so much as we had a discussion about how to sell that price point online. We knew that we weren't going to be able to change the price points and that we really didn't want to create a hierarchy of programming in terms of online being less valuable or providing less quality than our in-person workshop. So our conversations were really about how do we communicate that what people are going to receive through our online program is of equal value to what they would receive in an in-person program, and so that we could continue to make sure that that all of our workshop program, for example, is priced at exactly the same. And that was our main challenge, not so much discussing the price point as how to communicate what that price point actually delivered in terms of value and quality.
We were a little different at Melbourne Theatre Company, because we were presenting effectively a new product. So again, the advantages of economies of scale, MTC subscribes to Culture Counts, which some people will probably be aware is a nationwide service that surveys audiences. And so we just asked our audience what they'd be willing to pay. And we settled on $25 a unit. And so I think we've just actually been revisiting the figures recently, and it looks like that we'll probably recoup the production costs. It'll take about 3 years to recoup the costs. So for us, again, you know, despite the current circumstances, we are a company that can effectively cash flow an event like that. The other aspect is we've had, the advantage of working in the education sector is for our education resources, we've been able to get philanthropic funding to underwrite some of that. So we offer it at low cost to schools.
Okay, just to pick up on something you just said, I think I'm paraphrasing here because I should have written it down as you were speaking, but you said internal conversations were less about establishing a price and more about what marketing that price to the audience. Can you tell us a little bit about those conversations? Because I think for many organisations, large, small or medium, that would be a revealing conversation to share.
Yeah, absolutely. So it was about communicating, which I suppose is marketing in a very similar way. We couldn't run it for less. We unfortunately didn't have any access to funding, and because part of our core values are supporting writers, that included making sure that they were being paid for the work that they were doing. And certainly this would have been something that was sector-wide when it became very clear that the federal government wasn't going to offer a great deal of support to artists and to the art sector, that we didn't want to be part of the problem. We wanted to be part of the solution. So those conversations were very much about, and look, I want to be very clear, at this point in time, we hadn't done a good job of proving that we could deliver an online program. And that was something that we were also having to communicate as well, both internally and externally, and also prove. So at the beginning of the pandemic, when we had to pivot to online, there was a lot of communication going on, and we were very grateful because our community did take they did take a chance at following us online, trusting that we would deliver what we said that we were going to deliver. And we did land on a on a way that worked really, really well. So I don't want to I don't want to not say there was some luck involved in the fact that the idea, like the areas that we had identified and the way that we planned to meet those areas did happen to work. So there were those conversations as to how to do that, but they did happen to work. We did happen to land on a way that they worked in a way that worked going forward. So a lot of those communications, those internal communications, were about how we were going to make it work, how we could bring a program online, how we were going to talk to the tutors, how we were going to break down the structure, and then how we were going to get that information out to our writing community. And that communication was, you know, we're going to do it online and we promise that there's going to be a lot of quality and value here. It was also, we're not going to be able to deliver these in person. So if you are interested in furthering your creative practice, if you are interested in being involved in your writing while we're locked down, here's the way that we can support you with these writing workshops as well. So there was a two-prong marketing approach. One, you're in lockdown anyway, let's help you stay on a creative path. Two, we're going to help you do that by delivering quality and value. And And then we did through luck and skill and working really, really hard, and have been quite lucky to be able to have built that trust and now continue to deliver those programs in an ongoing way.
Right. We've got questions coming in from the audience, which I'll get to in just a moment, but I just have one or two, I think effectively one question for you each. Jeremy, can you speak briefly to the challenge of for the MTC of negotiating payments for kind of streamed performances? Clearly, you would have had to have a set of fairly detailed conversations with actors, with their agents, probably even with MEA as well, the Media Entertainment Arts Alliance. Can you just share briefly some of the challenges and some of the threads that were part of that conversation?
Yes, we're about, in terms of the pandemic, we're about 18 months ahead of the game, which was great. And in terms of on-demand theatre performance in Australia, on-demand video, Bell Shakespeare really had led the way by negotiating as far back, I think, as in the early 2000s to stream from Sydney Opera House their schools performances to schools in remote New South Wales that couldn't attend a theatre. So the MEAA pretty much had a framework ready to go in terms of actors. So a broadcast allowance, a one-off allowance, and then access to a royalty pool. So that was all pretty straightforward. And then we simply copied that offer across to creative artists who don't necessarily have a Peabody to represent their interests. I think the more complicated conversations were, it's all very well to have the framework, but still everybody has a right of approval to participate in this. And so they were the more nuanced conversations. And really it was about artists, how their work was going to be represented, work that they were creating for a live theatre experience, how that was going to be reflected online. And so some were, in some instances, they were more comfortable if it was a live streamed event because it was then, it was still ephemeral, that an audience would watch it in the moment and then it was gone. Others were nervous about the things that could go wrong and then be seen, or footage that could be captured off the screen, so more comfortable with an edited experience, which is what we've been doing. There was an added aspect for playwrights in when MTC licenses a play for production, we license it for Victoria only, generally. With playwrights, there's been a lot of conversations about what will the impact be of an on-demand digital theatre production of their work being available nationally on their ability to sell their work to other companies. So if, will a theatre company in Perth produced a new production of their work if Perth audiences can simply go to mtc.com.au and buy a recording. The evidence of, so National Theatre Live has been going for 14 years now, I think, or maybe longer. And the research suggests that when it comes to live theatre, that on-demand digital theatre encourages people to then go and buy a ticket to the real thing. Once they've seen online, the whole experience is a little demystified. They are more intrigued about what the live experience is and they're more likely to go and buy a ticket. So the research suggests that it doesn't cannibalize audiences. So a lot of the conversations have been referencing that research and that British experience to encourage artists to see this as an opportunity rather than a challenge to their work and audiences seeing their work.
Great, thank you. I will just apologise if people can start to hear background noise. The joy of being in lockdown, somebody appears to be renovating the flat upstairs above me. So apologies for that. Kate, a quick one for you before we get to audience questions. You mentioned that the team at Writers Victoria were upskilling. Can you kind of, was there any particular process you went about that to ensure that you and the team were effectively utilizing the digital sphere?
Yeah, absolutely. So we had been using a program called GoToWebinar prior to lockdown for our workshops. We all trained up on it. Then we decided that, in fact, GoToWebinar wasn't a good choice for us, and we switched to Zoom. And then we all upskilled on Zoom, making sure that we were all able to use the program and the different areas of the program across all of the different ways that we might need to use them in the workshop. I suppose we also upskilled ourselves in how to be in an online, be in a virtual environment. So learning how to gesture, learning how to look at the camera and not just at the person's face on the screen, the ways that we all now over emote on our faces to try and put that, just to sort of put those emotions through the camera, and also how to take care of ourselves while we're on screen as well, recognizing that those breaks were very necessary and that you do need to take time away from the screen. And that particularly for us, because we're mostly a professional and creative development service organization, that when you're teaching to a camera, it's a very different feel from teaching in person. You don't get the energy back from your students, and that it can be quite draining. So learning all of the balance as well, in terms of still being able to deliver what we needed to deliver, but making sure that we were taking care of ourselves and our community at the same time.
Right. A question for both of you from Tamer Simmons. In lockdown, there's no doubt that digital events have appeal and can be monetized. But if a digital event falls when we're out of lockdown, how do you attract audiences to stay and watch a screen if they can actually be in situ? Maybe Jeremy, we'll kick off with you briefly and then Kate.
Yeah, I think from the beginning, as I said before, pre-COVID, our imagining was that our target audience for this were people, for digital theatre products, were people who weren't coming to South Bank Theatre or Arts Centre Melbourne, weren't coming to South Bank in any case to see our live productions, either because they couldn't, because of some isolating factor, or, yeah, I guess that's the main reason, they just chose or couldn't come to see our shows. We have seen a spike every time we go into lockdown. Yes, we've seen a spike in terms of the purchases for digital theatre. But our goal has always been to develop this new additional audience outside of our, or in addition to our regular theatre going audience.
I think for us, it's actually been quite a humbling experience, because when we started delivering online programming, we realized the communities that we'd been letting down in the past by not supporting them. Our writers in regional and rural Victoria, for example, writers with disability, writers with caring responsibilities, writers who aren't able to take a whole day away for our in-person workshops. And the feedback that we've had has been universally positive. And it's allowed us to support our community so much better that we've actually committed to doing 50% of our program online going forward. So even when we were programming for this year, when we thought that we would be able to deliver a lot more in-person programming, we'd nonetheless programmed for 50% to be online. And even audiences that are able to come into the Wheeler Center, which is where we hold most of our in-person workshops, many of them are still choosing to do online workshops, depending on if the topic is of particular interest. Or we had some feedback from somebody who said that they prefer to do online just because they hate parking in the city. So we found that that online is allowing us to support our communities in a way that we hadn't really been doing before. And we haven't had any issues continuing to make it a really viable way of delivering our program going forward. And it's something that we are going to continue to do for the foreseeable future as we look at our program.
Great, thank you. Questions are coming in still from our audience. We won't have time to get to all of them, but there's some great questions coming in. A question for both of you from Fiorella Fabian, online events of particular appeal to audiences experiencing disability, what outreach and accessibility considerations have you adopted to cultivate and keep this audience? Kate, do you want to kick that one off?
That's a really good question. I spoke to it just briefly before. I think one of the reasons that we switched to Zoom from GoTo is because Zoom has some accessibility features built into it, including things like the live transcript, and it's an easy program to use. It doesn't require a great deal in terms of previous downloading or even a great deal of technological ability or understanding. It can be used at places like libraries when libraries are open as well. So that's one of the ways that we looked forward to helping to help our community with disability. It also allows, you can have captioning, you can also have somebody delivering, providing sign language as well, in as a window that's ongoing as well. There are accessibility issues that are built into online programming, particularly around access to computers, access to the internet. That is something that needs to be considered when thinking about an online program, and one of the reasons why we have not gone to an exclusively online program. But we found as well that it really does increase the accessibility more than add extra barriers.
I'd just add that I think the one aspect of the online or digital access that we've been trying to address since the very beginning is that while online access does enable a lot of marginalized communities or isolated people to access our work, there is big disparity in terms of people's actual access to the internet. We're really conscious of that, especially with we work with a number of schools and community organisations in remote Victoria, and where they don't have reliable access to the internet. We also work with some schools and communities of young people, in particular in Western Melbourne, in the Western suburbs and Southwest, who just don't have devices, don't have access to devices that are suitable for watching or using our resources. So we're just trying to address that. So I think that's an ongoing issue for us, and we have to be really aware of is to make sure that the technology itself or the infrastructure is, we're also conscious of this, of making that accessible.
Jeremy, while I've got you there, Judy Trenbath asks that whether you have details of the research you mentioned about not cannibalising audiences.
Yes, I was just scooting over in remote desktop to my work environment to find that. I will go and get that now and give that to the Arts Hub facilitator to share with everybody.
On mute, sorry. A question again for both. Kate, we'll start with you. Belle Hammond asks, did you find engagement levels for your digital products stayed the same, or have they dropped off over the period since you started offering?
So when we first began, there was a lot of hesitancy to go online from both our tutors and from the participants in the workshop. And we did have a few tutors prefer to postpone. So we were postponing rather than running the workshop online. When it became very clear that that was not going to be a sustainable solution, that we were going to have to either cancel or run it online. I feel like in many ways, the pandemic created a circumstance where we had to jump in with both feet. You didn't really have the option of not engaging in an online environment anymore, which helped again with that upskilling of both the organization and the tutors and the people who are attending our workshops. In the end, I think we had about 85%. We met about 85% of our program goals and when we switched online. So we did have some drop off, but it was very, very slight. And as we move forward into the digital future, that drop off is becoming less and less when, for example, I had to take some workshops online in the coming weekends because of these new stage six restrictions. When I emailed everybody and said, we're taking these workshops online, there wasn't anybody who pushed back and said, actually, I don't want to attend an online workshop. Everybody was quite comfortable and used to this being the way that things are, and that they would get what they wanted out of that workshop online.
Jeremy, any drop-off from the MTC side?
No, I mean, no. Our users of online resources and people logging into online experiences and digital theatre has just continued to grow for us. We've got robust audience growth in any case. Our greatest concern, I think a lot of people are aware of, is MTC, you know, apart from COVID, has an aging audience. And so for us, digital is a way of, at the moment, our digital theatre audience is about average age 10 years younger than our subscriber audience. So for us, this is an area of audience growth and audience development.
We've got about 4 minutes left, so just quickly, talk to us about marketing these digital events online. Presumably you were doing digital marketing, and this is the world we live in, but what was the most effective method? Facebook, your organization's website, etc. And also, do you do post-event follow-ups? Jeremy?
We found that there was... so far, we haven't found anything that is particularly unique or new in terms of making people aware of the digital product compared to our stage product, except for the fact that, I mean, mostly our marketing has been, it's been digital marketing, it's been online marketing. So Facebook and Instagram advertising is extremely effective in getting first-time buyers, what we call new-to-file. So people who have not previously bought a ticket to an MTC stage production, we've seen huge growth through digital theatre of people new-to-file, and that's basically been through digital marketing. With getting our subscribers, I mean, we do have this huge list of subscribers. In 2019, it was over 20,000. So you know, that they are there to be contacted, and they respond to electronic direct mail better than anything. So yeah, we just use those methods to bring them in.
Great. And Kate, just a quick response from you there.
Yeah, well, look, we used all of our socials as well. Our e-newsletter, which is same as direct mail to people who had engaged with the organization before, was the best thing and has the most tangible results. The best thing that we did for marketing for just in general to get people in, we ran a lot of events free for members on how to use Zoom. So we would set up times to say, come in and log into Zoom, and we will talk you through it before you have to actually attend a workshop. And that personal touch, I think, really helped as well. It helped cut through any of the fear and hesitancy that was there.
We are pretty much out of time. So a big thanks to both of our speakers, Kate and Jeremy, today. Big thanks also to the team at Creative Victoria, which Ruth is leading. Thanks also to the team at Arts Hub for helping facilitate this process. We've shared the links from Jeremy about the research on cannibalising events in the chat function. Apologies to those of you whose questions we didn't get answered. Lots of them were coming in. Our next session in this webinar series will be on Tuesday, the 31st of August, looking at the latest audience research with Tandy Palmer-Williams from Pattern Makers. So please put 1:30 p.m. Tuesday, the 31st of August in your diary. We'll be posting a full video and transcript of this session on the Arts Hub website later this week. Thank you again for joining us.